If the word of God is the seed, then your heart is the ground and you are the sower. How would you sow the word of God, which is the seed, into your heart? The Bible says you sow it by saying, you sow it by speaking.
Arise, 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 take your place, be enthroned on our prayer. Of you, one thing that we desire, that as we worship you, Lord, come and change our lives. Arise, 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 take your place. On our praise, arise, King of kings, holy God, as we sing, arise,
The essence of how faith works is this. The word of God can be conceived in our heart, and then the word of God produces what it says in our life. This is how faith works. We talked about Mary and how God's word came to her and how the conception happened and so on. The word of God, God has made our hearts in such a way that it can receive the word, conception, a kind of conception can take place, and then it begins to birth things. Another way that the Bible explains, a major way that the Bible explains how the faith works, is in terms of sowing a seed in the ground and how the seed begins to grow. That is why I wanted you to turn to Mark chapter 4, verse 26. I want to read from verse 26 to 29. And he said, the kingdom of God is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground and should sleep by night and rise by day, and the seed should sprout and grow. He himself does not know how, for the earth yields crop by itself, first the blade, then the head, after that the full grain in the head. And when the grain ripens, immediately he puts in the sickle, because the harvest has come. Now, you know that in this chapter, this great parable of the sower is there, and it begins in verse 3 itself. Many things are already established by way of interpretation, several things. One is, already established is the fact that the word of God is the seed. That you see in verse 14 itself. The sower went forth to sow the word of God, he says. So the word of God is the seed. The second fact that is established is the soil is the heart of man into which the word of God is sown. Soil is the heart, is your heart. Thirdly, you are the sower. That is established here in verse 26 where we read, the kingdom of God is as if a man should cast seed on the ground. The way it is said, it looks like it's talking about any man. The kingdom of God is as if a man should cast seed on the ground. So the sower is not Jesus. It's not talking about Jesus as the sower who sows the word into our hearts. It is talking about any man sowing seed into the ground. It's talking about generally anybody, you or I or anybody, sowing the seed into the ground. So the sower is us, you and I, everybody. We are the sowers. So we are the sowers. Our heart is the ground in which the seed is sown. And the word of God is the seed. And finally, the fourth thing is the way in which the word is sown. The confession of God's word is the way by which we sow the word of God into our hearts. Since the word is since the seed is the word, how do you sow it? See, if you have a bag of seeds, you won't put it in your mouth and chew on it. You know that this is a bag of seed, you'll go and sow it in the ground. But here the word is the seed. He says the word of God is the seed. If the word of God is the seed, then your heart is the ground and you are the sower. How would you sow the word of God, which is the seed, into your heart? The Bible says you sow it by saying, you sow it by speaking. When you take the word of God, when you put it in your mouth, that's why I talked about how the word must be in your mouth and in your heart. God said to Joshua, let this book not depart out of your mouth. So there is something about this mouth, taking the word of God in our mouth, speaking it. And when we speak it, it is sown in our hearts. So confession of God's word is how the seed of God's word is sown in our hearts. Now, this is a thing that many Christian people have missed and many people over the generations have missed. And even in the beginning of times, even in the case of Israelites, that is what they missed. The people of Israel that came out of Egypt. They missed it because God delivered them from the hands of Pharaoh, brought them out and everything. But yet they could not possess the promises of God. The reason they could not possess the promises of God is because they just could not get this thing straight in their head that the word of God, they must take the word of God and put it in their mouth and they must speak it, you know. The book of Hebrews says it in so many words. And if you read in book of Hebrews chapter 4, for example, in verse 2, it says it like this. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. It says the word which they heard did not profit them. See, the people of Israel had the gospel preached to them. Moses was their pastor. There was about 3 lakhs people out in the wilderness. Their church was in the wilderness. It was an air-conditioned church. There was a pillar of cloud by day. God cooled it and made it nice. And gave them Pastor Moses and assistant Pastor Aaron and Joshua and Caleb and all these wonderful people. Something was preached to them. They were told who they were, that they were Abraham's children, that they had a covenant with God. They were told that God has given them commandments, 10 commandments. They were told about the way of worship, the sacrifices and offerings and feasts and festivals. All these methodologies were given to them. All of that is to aid them in their worship and in understanding salvation and the plan and purpose of God for their life. And finally, to bring them into the promised land. The aim is to bring them into the promised land. So with this wonderful pastor, with all the teaching, with all the truth, with the word of God written to them, written with the finger of God himself, the 10 commandments written on a stone and given to them, these people could not get into the promised land. The reason is this. The reason is, it says here, even though the word was preached to them, they did not profit. Now, profit is something that everybody understands. I don't have to explain that. Profit is something that everybody understands. They could not profit, it says. Why? They did not mix with faith the word that they heard was not mixed with faith in those who heard it. That is, they heard the word, but they did not mix with faith that word that they heard. They heard the word, but something was missing. That's what it means. And what was missing? They did not mix faith with the word. They did not mix with faith. Now, everybody understands mixie these days. Mixie is a device that we have in our kitchens these days that grinds our masala, right? And even if some people don't believe in using it because they like the taste of the natural grind better, nowadays it's become so fashionable, everybody has a mixie just for the looks of it in the kitchen, even if they don't use it, you know. So everybody understands mixie and what it does. Mixie mixes, that's why it's called mixie. It mixes everything, grinds everything, brings everything together and gives it to you conveniently. Now, God wanted the word that was preached to them to be mixed in some way. The mixer that God has given, now no Israelite could say, I don't have a mixer. The mixer that God gave to them is the mouth. Have you ever wondered why the tongue goes like that, you know? That's a mixer. And nobody could say, no, I don't have a mixer. Everybody had a mixer. No one without a mixer. They were supposed to take the word of God that was preached to them, the promises of God. God said, I've given you this land. God said, I've got houses that you didn't build, vineyards that you didn't plant, wells you did not dig. I've got milk and honey there. So they need to open their mouth and take what was preached to them, this message about milk and honey and God's wonderful, amazing purposes for their lives to lead them into the promised land. They need to take those words and put it in their mouth and begin to say that this land is my land because God has given it to me. The promised land is mine. Every promise of God is mine. They're supposed to speak it. That is the way they are supposed to mix it. What happened was they heard it, but they did not mix it. They heard the word preached, but they did not mix it. So 30 lakhs people in the church, big church, and a wonderful pastor, Moses, but yet because they did not mix it, they never got to enjoy any one of the things that was promised. They died and perished in the wilderness because they did not mix it. Now, that's the problem even today. The reason why people have a problem with speaking God's word is this. They say, when you confess God's word, when you begin to speak God's word, you're speaking something that is unreal, not true about your life. They say it amounts to a lie. When you say, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus, and don't have any money in your pocket, and in debt, and you're in deep financial problem, how can you say something like that? That would amount to a lie, they say. You're telling us to lie. When you say, by his stripes, we were healed. When we are not even healed, we're laying in a hospital bed. How can we say, by his stripes, we were healed? It amounts to a lie, they say. But really, confession, the word confession, if you just take an ordinary dictionary and check it in an ordinary dictionary, the word confession simply means saying the same thing as. Now, in our case, in the case of our context, where we're talking about confessing the word of God, it means confessing what God has said, saying the same things as God has said. Confession is saying the same thing as. In our case, it's the confession or saying the same thing as what God has said. Now, how can you say that what God has said is a lie? You can't tell a person who's confessing God's word that he's confessing a lie. He's only confessing God's word. Lie is something different. Lie is different because lie is where a person tries to make people believe that he's got something that he doesn't have. A Christian who confesses God's word is not lying. He's not trying to make people believe something that is not true about him. No, he's not trying to tell people he's got something when he does not have it. No, anybody that hears a Christian confession When you hear me say, my God shall supply all my needs, you know very well I'm not lying about something. I'm not lying and saying that I've got all that I need to build the church or something like that, you know. I'm not lying. I'm, in fact, I don't have it. And you realize very well I'm simply opening my mouth and saying what God has said about that need and about that challenge that is there before us. It is not lying. Everybody realizes that. Lying is where a person is trying to make somebody believe that something is true when it is not true. Confession is where a person is simply saying what God has said, because what God has said is truth, you know. So it is so important to realize that the truth about how faith works, how confession works, and how faith operates, really. Faith operates like this, when a person becomes a sower, when a person becomes a Christian, he becomes a sower of God's word. He begins to sow God's word in his heart constantly. God's word concerning his spirit, soul, and body, and about every need of his life. He begins to take the promises of God and what God says and begins to speak it in order to sow it in his heart. That is what a life of faith is all about, you know. And faith life is like this. You know, faith life is very special. You know, you need to understand what faith life is. Faith life is not like when you got a problem, you go to church and try to find a preacher or somebody anointed to get rid of your problems, you know. And next time you go to church is when you have a problem, you know. Have you seen some people? They'll be in church when they have a problem. As soon as you see them, you know they got a problem, you know. That's why they're there, you know. Last time when they had a problem 2 years ago, they were here. And this time when they have a problem again, they'll come back now, you know. They're going from one problem to another. They go from one crisis to another. They go from one difficulty to another. They think church is a place where there are preachers who just helps them over that problem. And after that problem is over, they go do whatever they want. And then when they come upon another problem, then they remember the preacher or some other preacher and go there, try to fix the problem. Some people think that's what Christian life is. No, Christian life is different. It's a life of faith. The just shall live by faith. That's what Christian life is. It's a life of faith. A life of faith is a life, you know. It's a long process. It is for the long haul. It is not a short-term thing, you know. It's not just going and trying to get something, at the time of your need and then forgetting about everything. No, it's for the long haul. It is something that you get into and you journey through life. You live a life of faith, fulfilling God's purposes for your life, you know. So you need to understand, faith is about living a life of faith, not just trying to get your needs met here and there. I spoke about miracles, you know, some time ago. The difference between miracles and blessings. The difference is very important. Nothing wrong with miracles. God has done so many miracles for me. I'm sure he has done miracles for you. Thank God for God's miracles. If you take me to a place where people don't know God and they have so many needs and they're sick and they have problems, they have difficulties and they don't know God, I'll probably preach very much about miracles and how God is a great miracle worker and how God will help them. And I believe that God will help them and do miracles. And I've seen God do many miracles in my life and other people's life. I have no problem with that. But if those very same people came to the church, I will not be talking about miracles. I'll be talking about blessing. Because when blessing is there, you don't need miracles. Blessing is greater. When blessing is there, you don't need miracles. In Genesis chapter 1, before the fall, in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, you don't read about how God did miracles every day for Adam to feed him. How God had to miraculously meet his needs and supply his needs every day. But when I joined Bible college, I remember the first year when I was in Bible, I've told you, you know, I had no money. I ended up in another country without any money and I had to count my pennies, literally. That's how I lived. And I had to have miracles. One of the best things I had was Oral Roberts' book on miracles every day. It was a devotional book, I remember, you know. Every day you read it, and I would read it every day because I needed money for that day. If God didn't do a miracle for that day, my friend, I couldn't even wash my clothes, you know. So I needed a miracle for the day. So I know. And I have experienced God's miracles. And I would read that book every day. Miracles every day. I needed a miracle today. I needed a miracle tomorrow. I needed a miracle next day. I lived like this for many days like that I experienced. But then soon, I moved from miracles to blessing. And I totally forgot about miracles, if you ask me. Such miracles, the miracles of God meeting my needs and making my provisions miraculously, were long forgotten. And after many years, I was thinking, well, God, I haven't seen that kind of miracles anymore. It's been a long time since I saw one of those miracles. You know, when I was young, I saw those miracles. Why isn't that happening now? God reminded me, do you want to come back to the days when you had only 2 quarters in your pocket? I'll do the miracles. I'm in a different condition now. I don't need miracles now. I am living on a different level. I'm living on the level called blessing. When you have blessing, you don't need miracles. I don't need a miracle today to eat my lunch today. My lunch is already ready, waiting for me. I just have to get there, you see. I don't need a miracle for me to pay my rent this month or next month, you know. It's already ready. I don't need a miracle. Some people may need it, but I don't need a miracle. And if you ask me, I have lived by miracles and I've lived by blessing. I know that blessing is better. Amen. Truthfully. Like one preacher, John Osteen, used to say, Joel Osteen's dad, used to say, I've been poor and I've been rich, and rich is better, he said. That's the truth, isn't it? Anybody that says anything otherwise is a liar. And there's a lot of liars among Christians many times. So, it's wonderful to live under blessing. And faith is about blessings and accessing the blessings of God and living in the blessing of God. Faith is not just about miracles and receiving God's miracles for your life. It's wonderful that by faith you can believe God for some miracles and God does miracles for you. But faith does not stop there with miracles. Faith, when it is properly taught, it must take you from a life of miracles to a life of blessing. If it doesn't take you, graduate you from miracles and take you to blessing, then faith is not properly taught for you. Faith must lead you ultimately to the blessings of God.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever and ever. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever and ever, forever. Love and joy.
by the grace of God, we will carry on. Everybody.
Love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing.